Hello children, welcome to today's discussion. The topic we are going to take up today is the birth of the United Nations. To understand any organization, its impact and effects, especially a world body like the UNO, we need to know why it started, how it started, where it started, etc. To have a better understanding about the UNO and its birth, let us listen to the discussion between Mr. Tharkar, Special Envoy to the UNO, and Ms. Naina Singh, reporter with the famous newspaper World Times. This is the first in the two series discussion about the UNO between the two of them. In the first segment, they will be discussing the birth of the UNO, and in the second segment, they will be discussing about the work of the UNO and its functions. Today, we will listen to the discussion between Mr. Sameer Tharkar and Ms. Naina Singh, where they will be talking about the birth of the United Nations.
Thank you for the warm welcome. Thank you, Mr. Sameer Tharkar, for giving me this opportunity to interact with you and for agreeing to share your knowledge about the origin of the UNO with us.
I am very excited to be a part of this discussion. In fact, my ambition is to be a part of a UN mission once I finish my education. So it is a great opportunity for me to know firsthand about the birth of the UNO and to know more about it from such an eminent statesman like Mr. Sameer Tharkar.
Thank you all very much for this opportunity to speak to you all. The UNO is a very special organization and it plays a very important role in world affairs. It's good to know about its birth. Since the origin, why it started, how it started, etc., all have a bearing on its present functioning and its future impact.
Sir, can you give us a brief idea about the circumstances in the world before the birth of the UNO?
You are a very good reporter, Ms. Naina. You have gone straight to the crux of the issue. We need to go back to the time of the Industrial Revolution. As you know, the Industrial Revolution occurred in Europe. It started in Britain and then spread to other European countries. As a result of the Industrial Revolution, many European countries became rich. With the setting up of big industries, it led to large-scale production of goods. These industrialized European nations needed two important things: A. New markets to sell their goods, and B. Raw materials for their industries. So they started to take over poor and weak nations. India was one of the nations which was colonized by Britain.
Were there other European countries which were also the conquerors or the colonial powers?
Yes, of course, Vedant. Spain, France, the Netherlands, Portugal, and Germany all started conquering other weaker nations. And in this race to get more colonies for themselves, the European nations started fighting among themselves. Mr. Tharkar, can you give us a brief idea about these wars?
Since most of the countries at that time were involved in these wars, they generally came to be known as the World Wars. These wars left the world shattered. There was a tremendous loss of life and property. Vedant, can you tell me, have you heard of the World Wars? And if so, how many World Wars have been fought so far?
Sir, there has been two World Wars so far. World War I and World War II. I have seen many movies which have dealt with these subjects. I saw the movie Pearl Harbor. It was about the attack on Pearl Harbor in World War II.
Excellent. So you already have a good idea about the wars. Let us first look at World War I. World War I. 1. It lasted from 1914 to 1918. 2. On one side were Germany, Austria, Hungary and Turkey. 3. On the opposing side were Britain, France, USA and Russia. When these colonial powers fought against each other, naturally the colonies which were under their control were also dragged into the war. 4. Due to the war, there were lakhs of people who were killed and injured. Many died due to the diseases caused by war and famine. 5. The damage caused, both in terms of lives and property, was incalculable. 6. Some estimates say 85 lakh men died in battle. 2 crore 10 lakh were wounded, and 2 crores died to diseases, etc., caused by war.
Oh my God! Those are such huge numbers! The destruction, loss of life and property is unimaginable.
When the loss of life and property was taken after World War I, the countries realized that this kind of loss was too much and should not occur in the future. That is why they set up the League of Nations. It came into effect in 1919 to ensure that no future wars occur on such a large scale and to end conflict among nations. It lasted till 1941. The League of Nations was not very effective as it could not prevent World War II.
So in a way, the League of Nations is a precursor to the UNO, isn't it?
Yes, you are right, Vedant. But before we start discussing the UNO, we need to first look at World War II. World War II. 1. World War II lasted from 1939 to 1945. 2. On one side were Germany, Italy and Japan, and on the other side were almost all the remaining countries led by Britain, France, USA, etc. 3. The event which brought the World War II to an end was the dropping of the atom bomb on Hiroshima and Nagasaki in Japan by the Allied forces. 4. The loss far outstripped the loss as seen in World War I. More than 5 crore people died. Cities and towns were bombed and destroyed. Loss to property was tremendous.
So it was truly a global war.
Yes. It was a war which changed the entire world. It led to the growth of the UNO. From 1945, the UNO has done its best to ensure that a global war does not take place. Mr. Tharkad, can you tell us about the UNO, its birth, its aim and objectives?
People were shocked at the loss caused by the Second World War. They felt that money wasted on the war efforts could be better utilized for good of mankind. This would result in peace, progress and prosperity. Based on this principle, the UNO was set up in 1945 with 51 member nations. Today, the UNO has 193 member nations.
The main objectives of the UNO are 1. To save future generations from wars. 2. To work for peace and security of all nations. 3. To protect human rights and freedom all over the world. 4. To remove differences based on sex, religion, language, race, etc. 5. To encourage friendly relations among different nations of the world. 6. To solve all international problems peacefully and through cooperation. 7. To help nations in the achievement of all the objectives mentioned above.
These objectives have a very vast and wide scope and so help resolve conflict in all areas. It also helps not just in stopping wars, but also in promoting peace and security, thereby ensuring prosperity and growth for all nations. It aims to treat all nations equally.
Yes, the UNO, in an effort to ensure freedom and equal rights for the people in all nations, has brought out the Universal Declaration of Human Rights in 1948. These are 4 individual rights for all people. These human rights are 1. Freedom of speech. 2. Freedom of religion. 3. Freedom from fear. 4. Freedom from poverty. The UNO also works to ensure the following for all the people: equality before law, the right to education, the freedom of worship, the right to employment, equal pay for equal work, the right to live as free citizens, the freedom of speech and writing, the freedom to have one's own views, the freedom to travel anywhere one likes, the freedom to marry according to one's wish.
The UNO has done excellent work to prevent local wars from becoming world wars. It has done much useful work in the field of human rights, food security, labor laws, etc. But as the large problems of poverty, illiteracy, overpopulation, diseases, etc. still exist in many nations of the world, the work and efforts of the UNO must continue without any hindrances or stoppage. With that, I hope all of you have got a good idea about how the UNO began, what are its aims and objectives, and how does it continue to work with progress.
Thank you very much, Mr. Tharkad. It was great getting to know in detail about the birth of the UNO and its objectives. We also realized that though many people criticize the working of the UNO and state that it is ineffective and so must be removed, but as major world problems like poverty, illiteracy, etc. still exists, the UNO must and should continue.
I do agree. The UNO is as useful and relevant today as it was earlier when it started. Thank you very much for sharing so much of information about the UNO with us.
That was a very interesting and informative discussion. I'm sure everyone enjoyed it. We know that the UNO is relevant even today. In our next session, we will discuss the functions of the UNO. Till then, goodbye and good luck.